So what we want to do today is just see, wait, did I reject someone by mistake? And yes, yeah. 1 minute. So today we want to just study more properties of trees, okay? And it will have the general flavor, at least the first few properties, that trees are very flexible. You can go from one tree to the other by using exchange and such, okay? So basically, in some sense, we will study flexibility of trees, at least the first few results, and then I'll go to something related to cuts and such, which we have started earlier. So flexibility of trees, meaning that basically, so what is a tree? Anybody can quickly define, just recall for us, what is a tree? Without a cycle, right? So it's a connected graph without a cycle. It's a minimum connected graph. So because it is at the extreme end of the spectrum of all connected graphs, right? So trees are an extremal object. Extremal objects are always interesting, okay, in mathematics. And an extremal object, why is it extremal? Because it is a graph which is connected, but at the same time, it has an extremal property that it has minimum. You can say it in terms of minimum number of edges. You can say it in terms of cycles. You can say it in so many other ways. Okay. And because it's an extremal object, it is intrinsically very interesting, but also it is important in studying connectivity in general. Is that right? Because it is extremal, right? And how have we seen this? We have seen this by applications of minimum spanning trees in so many problems, right? Problems where it was nothing to do with trees to begin with, but we went to the minimum spanning tree and we solved the problem. You can recall many problems, and maybe you have come across others if you have looked around, right? That's my point, that extremal objects are always interesting, and we will keep seeing this phenomena elsewhere when we have a family of objects. And we want to prove something about that family of objects, we will instead prove it about the extremal member of that family, something like that. And then, so we will see such things recurring again and again. Because when you assume extremality, you are making one more assumption, and the object becomes more concrete because it's extremal, and so on. Okay. So, yeah. So in this topic about how trees are very flexible, we have already proved several results along these lines, okay? So we have already seen, I'll mention a few of them, some results along these lines. So just give me 1 minute. Not about the result, but okay. So we've already seen some results related to flexibility of trees. Can anybody recall any result that we proved about trees, which kind of brings out the flexibility in trees? Any examples? Or just if you can state some general properties of trees, or through the theorem statement, or through some application, whatever you recall or were best impressed by. Any examples where we had seen, you know, results of this kind? So maybe to be more specific, flexibility of trees, what does that imply? It implies that trees are very easily constructible, right? Easily constructible. And sure enough, we have seen this, right? We even saw algorithms, simple algorithms to construct different kinds of trees. Easily constructible, right? What was the way to construct trees? You know, just to start with endpoints. Well, obviously you can make a path, that's easy, but also But also if you simply, so it's like you don't have to think much, right? You just start with an edge. So just talking about this constructibility, just start with an edge, just add another edge, just make sure that there is no cycle. And that's it, boom, you have a tree, right? In the end, after some steps, how many steps and so on we have seen, right? And so that's one phenomena, right? Where trees are very easily constructible. Any other, since now I've given one example, so maybe it's all about the question not being clear, right? I'm not being able to say it in a good way. Otherwise, you can obviously tell me the theorems. So what was another similar result we have proved? Yes? Yes, that is also there, right? It forms. So if something is very easily constructible, like you don't have to think much while, just imagine, like while constructing something, you don't have to be very, very careful. You can just, pay attention to some very small thing and that kind of object gets constructed. But then that also means that you can go from one object of that type to another object of that type easily. It's all interconnected, right? Yeah. So So what you're saying is perfectly correct. And can you make that specific through a theorem that we have proved? So we can go from, if you have two trees, you can go from T to T prime easily or something like that. Yeah. Just give me 1 minute. There's some call coming up. Take it. One second. Sorry.
Hello. Bolo. ठीक है आप लोग आ जाओ छात्रों तो लीजिए ना एक सेकेंड फिर बात करो
सॉरी यस गो ऑन हेलो यस प्लीज से ओह सॉरी हेलो आई एम ऑडिबल Yes. So Ritam, I think you were saying something, right? About going from one tree to the other. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So the point is that you can, easily hear what I mean is that given two trees, you can kind of move from one to the other, right? How can you do that? For this, we have proved some results like this. Now, I'm not going to strictly say it. What I had proved is like, given an edge in a tree T, you remove that edge from the tree, right? Then you will find an edge in T prime that you can chuck it in this tree, where you can find some edge, such that this is again a tree. And you see, slowly, you can use this to move to T prime. So it's like you can go from one tree to the other so easily. So the graph of all trees is a highly connected graph. Something like that. Okay. So we had proved this result. Okay. And you can go back and look at it. And actually, you don't need to know the theorem statement, but you should know the idea. Okay. So you can go back and this was very crucial. We had used this in proving the algorithm of minimum spanning tree. Okay. Okay. So far, so good. Let's come to the third thing. What was the third kind of phenomena which we had. So usually flexibility will come in these forms in general in mathematics. Obviously, I'm not making any claim here, but I'm saying that something can be easily constructible or easily traversable from one object of that family to the other. Or what is another thing which is rather more concrete and more enumerative in nature? Anyone? We had counted the number of trees, right? And we had shown there were many, many trees. Something like this we had shown. All these point at the same thing or similar thing, right? Like if you can construct an object, so there is a family of objects and you can construct them by a very easy rule, like there's not many conditions to actually get to them, then obviously it's natural that there will be many, many of them. So we had seen these things, right? And now, and this is rather more concrete. I mean, obviously this is an example of a family of objects where each we saw each of these three phenomena, right? Like very concretely, we didn't really, like you don't really need to attend this class to know this one, this result. It was easy. We could go. But I mean, in general, in mathematics, it could be hard. Okay. So you may not be able to see all of them so like discreetly. Anyways, we want to see a fourth kind of phenomena of this type. And this is also, these are basically these theorems. Okay, not all of them. Okay, this is there in a separate chapter, but more or less they are there in the book Douglas Best. Okay, so the next theorem I'm going to do is also there, but maybe they state it in a more technical way and they have a lot of other things in between. So you have to really, you know, go through it and if you want to read it. But yeah, so we will now go for one more phenomena of this type. Someone is joining. Okay. Okay. So let's go for one more phenomena of this type. Now I'll remove this word flexibility because this might be controversial. But here is the thing. 1 minute. Yes. Okay. So let G be a general graph. So well, this will again be like trees can be found easily in places. So if let G be a graph okay, let me say it like this. If G is a graph, G be a graph such that every vertex, you see, every vertex has at least k neighbors. We can just make this for the moment. We can let's keep it a number, at least 100 neighbors. So obviously it means that the graph must have at least 101 points. And that is obvious. Okay. But this is more than that. Yeah, this is saying that every vertex has at least 100 neighbors. So this vertex, this has 100 things coming out of it to some things. Then you take this guy, this red one, he also has 100 neighbors. Already one neighbor is here. Some neighbors might be here. Some neighbors may be extra. So every vertex has 100 neighbors. It's possible, right? These kind of graphs where every vertex has at least this many neighbors is very naturally arising graph, right? You can think about it. So yeah, this is also said in a technical way as delta case. A delta represents the minimum degree, okay, among all vertices, that delta G is at least K. But we don't need, or at least 100. We don't need to say it now. Otherwise, I mean, it might get uncomfortable. The whole point of this thing might get lost. Okay. For some of us may be more comfortable with notations, and that's fine. Yeah. So this is the situation. Okay? This is a general graph, so that every vertex has 100 neighbors. Okay. That is the thing. 1 minute. Okay, sorry. Yeah, right. Okay, so here is a question. Does G have to be connected? Just to get a sense of things. Does G have to be connected? Yeah, so that's a big no. Because you can have many, many vertices, right? So obviously there is no question. You can have 1 million vertices and then there's no reason why it should be connected. So the answer is no. Anyone finds this surprising? I'm not asking for a proof, but does anybody find it surprising that the answer is no? Do you think, does anybody think the answer is yes? Okay, graphs are very general objects. You can just construct many, many things and you can do anything almost. That's why if some necessary condition holds, if there is some necessary condition and is general enough, then sufficient also. Okay, now let T be an arbitrary, some general tree, okay, arbitrary, some tree, not necessarily a path or anything. Let T be an arbitrary tree with 100 vertices or edges, 100 edges. Yeah, because this is about edges. Okay, so T is just a tree with 100 edges. Okay, then T can be found in G. Now, what do I mean by this? I mean that you can start with G, you can remove some edges from G and maybe some vertices also, and you will end up with T. We'll do an example with small numbers. Okay, T can be found in G, means that you take G, G is a rich graph. Okay, then I'm saying that you can remove some vertices from G. In particular, you need only 101 vertices now to get T. So there will be some vertices you can remove. I'm not saying which ones, I do not know, but some vertices which you can remove, some edges which you will have to remove, and but then you will end up with T. If you do it correctly, you will end up with T. So every tree with 100 edges or 101 vertices can be found in this graph. This is once again saying the same phenomena in some sense. Let's take an example. Let's do an example with very small numbers. And the proof is surprisingly easy, but it has a new technique. Not new, but it's a technique which will, again, you'll keep using it throughout, just whenever in life you're studying graph theory. This keeps coming. So let's do a very small example. Okay. So let's keep, so I'm just using K for edges. Let's keep K equal to 4. I want to make an arbitrary tree with 4 edges, just an arbitrary tree, okay? So I'm just making it arbitrarily. I have not planned this or anything. So 4 edges means I will need vertices, so like this, and I just make an arbitrary tree. So I don't want to choose a special tree so that, you know, I prove my point. It's not like, I'm saying that just pick an arbitrary tree with 4 edges. Now let us pick a graph. So this is the tree that we want to find inside that graph. So let me put it here. What I mean by this, this is the arbitrary tree. So don't yet think about the proof now. Some proof is not difficult, but just try to understand why this is happening, why this should be happening. Like, why would you predict such a thing, something like that? Okay. Arbitrary tree with 4 edges. This is the T. This is the T. Now let's make a graph. That will be a bit more work. Again, I will make an arbitrary graph. Again, arbitrary graph. I'm not choosing a special graph so that I'll find this tree. So forget about this tree for a moment. Okay. Maybe this could have been done more interactively. I mean, that you make a tree, someone makes a tree with 4 edges and someone else makes a graph, and then we try to find it. You can try to do that maybe, okay, after the class. That's really, because even after you know the proof, really doing it is. So G is again an arbitrary graph, but I need to make sure that every vertex is 4 edges. So let's see. So let me just first put some edges randomly. I will not put some vertices. I'll not put 5 vertices. I'll put some many vertices. Okay. Let's label them. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay. Now, you guys tell me how I should join, how I should make the G. So Okay, let me say more clearly. Make a G such that every vertex has at least four neighbors, such that delta G is at least four. Okay, and try to avoid this kind of pattern inside the tree, inside the graph, sorry. Try to avoid this kind of pattern. Try to avoid this kind of pattern. Avoid T. And you see, I've not labeled the vertices. It's just that we do not want to see such a thing. We do not want to see such a thing in our graph. You see my point? We don't want to see such a thing. You see, this is a tree. If you forget about the sorry. No, we don't want to see it even once in the G, right? And we will see that we will fail. Okay. So, you can see there are no labelings on this, so you are free to pick any five vertices, it doesn't matter, and find such a structure which looks like this. So if for example if you see this and maybe you also see you have this. Okay, but still this structure has been found. Yeah, one second. Just 1 second. Ritam, is your question answer? Yes, that's why I said that's why I said that to find G, you may have to remove vertices, and at the same time, you may have to remove some edges also. Yeah. And to say this very precisely, T is there is a subgraph of G which is isomorphic to T. That is the whole thing, but then I have to spend 15-20 minutes into this notation. Okay. So anyways, yes, Raghav, your question. Yes, you can ignore that. That's like, we have already ignored this, right? 4 and 7. Yeah. So the point is that suppose this was the graph, suppose this was G, okay, then what will I do? I will say, okay, remove these things, remove this. You have your tree. That's what I mean by T can be found in G. Right? So you can remove. So you can remove it. You're not allowed to add anything in G, but you can remove whatever you want. That's what I mean by found. It's a substructure. It is not an induced substructure because you are shedding off further things than just vertices. Okay. All right. So in order to get a feel for this, what you should try to do, I'm trying to make sure that I can prove this theorem. So I'm constantly in my mind, just my mind is jumping. Can I prove it? So just give me 1 second. Let me just make sure that, yeah, this is a habit of mine. 1 second. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Yeah. It's not a good habit because it's like I'm trying to recall the proof. Okay. But it is just that, especially when I'm taking a class, right? So to be like, okay, I should know it. Okay. Anyways. Yeah. So the point is that proof will come later, but if you want to get a feel for this, right, then what you should do, you should take a graph like this and put these conditions, like I will, so we know that if you take any graph, so what we want to prove is that if I take any graph and every vertex has 4 degrees, 4 neighbors at least, then you cannot avoid finding the t inside the graph. Okay, so to get a feel, we will try to avoid and see why it is failing. Now, what do you mean by try to avoid? This means you take a g and from every vertex you give 4 neighbors, but you try to avoid the tree. Is it okay with everyone? Yes, yes. I mean, we will fail, but okay. So how we will attempt to do it is we will obviously fail. That's what the theorem is saying, right? That you will fail. You will not be able to avoid it. Maybe that's why you don't understand because it's not correct what I'm saying. So that's why it feels wrong, because it is wrong. Okay. Yeah, it's almost obvious that you cannot avoid it, but let's see. So suppose from one, I join 4 neighbors. It doesn't matter which 4 I join. Doesn't matter. No, right? I can just join any 4 because it's just starting. So we can do any 4. Or maybe let's keep it simple. We can just join this and join. So this is a start. Okay. So obviously if 4 is the thing, I don't want to pick more than 4 because my situation will get worse. If I take a vertex and I put more than 4 edges, right? It will just get worse. Like this. Now you guys tell me what I should do. No, not yet. Not yet. Yes. So the problem is a very silly tree. It's a very something stupid tree, right? Because Okay. So how should we make a different tree? How do we try to make a different tree so that? Yeah, because it's already that it has. Okay, so let's make a different tree. That is certainly can be done. Yeah, I think that is good to do, important to do. I mean, we can still do try to see it. That means I can say and be okay. But yeah, the point is, yeah, we should increase. Let's make it 5. Okay, but then we have to choose a tree in such a way that no vertex has degree 5. Otherwise, we'll already find it as Raghav said. So we will try to make a tree in which no vertex has degree 5. Obviously, it will have 6 edges. So 3 to 5 and 1, 6. And let's make a tree like this. This is called a complete binary tree. We will see its connections with countings and such also. These are special trees. It will get a cycle. So what am I doing? No, this cannot be done. Sorry. No problem. So no. Then you'll need 6, you'll need 7 vertices. So 1 minute. So we'll just make it. So we need 6 edges. Here are the 6 edges. And note that no vertex has degree 5. Pretty imbalanced tree. 3 and 4. This one, right? Okay. So let's make this. Okay, so now we have 5 edges. Okay. So again, this time when I start with 5 edges, I don't get the tree. Okay, now let's try. Yeah, certainly. Yeah, we will get it after a few steps. That's right. So let's see. Let's continue and see. So let's try to avoid. So what should we do with 2? That's a good point, right? Why do you say that? Okay. Yeah. But I think it makes sense, right? Yeah. That's right. So in the second step, let's keep the red color only. So in the second step, we do this. So just we have to make sure that we don't get the tree. I think I know we'll be getting, or we are, yeah. No, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Wait. Yeah, we will get here only if we do that. Right? Yeah. We are. Yeah, then you have to take one outside, right? So okay, so first my question is to the others also who. So do you see that you have the tree T in this structure? Or is it true? Or is it not true? For everyone, this is a question. Do you see that tree, the T is already here in this? You can tell me the specific words. It is not here? Okay. Does everybody see that? Okay. For everybody, can you tell me the exact edges? I mean, there will be many possibilities here, but which form the tree T so that it's clear for everyone? Oh. Okay. This side, okay, this side. Okay. Okay. Right. And so does everybody see that? Yes, that's right, that's right. So let me remove some things so that it will be more clear, maybe. 1 8 1 10. So I'm just removing and showing that you can find it. 1 8 1. No, it will just become easy. I mean, you avoid it, you don't need it, right? You can just take the smallest graph with such properties and so on. But it is clear that the theorem is true. Let me just remove what I don't need. 1 second. Yes, yeah. This is the tree. You can see now, you can say they look different, but they are the same trees. Does everybody see that? Okay, so the theorem is now self, it's evident. It's right. It seems like it is true. Almost. Proof, think about a proof. We will do the proof in the next class. Because yeah, you should take your time and do more of and just play around more or something like that. Do some interesting stuff with this. Okay. Proof next time. Proof is not difficult, but I'll not say anything because yeah, and also if some of you can do the proof, then please tell us. We will hear. Maybe you're gonna get a different proof. Okay. And then more questions here can be asked as to how many copies of T you can find in it. And there are many, many interesting questions that can be asked. And in fact, some of them are still open, I think. Okay, so this goes very deep. Yes, we were trying to avoid, right? But we could not avoid. Is that right? Yeah. So that's why I made a special tree. I made a tree. So I mean, if I would have taken a tree like this, then clearly you cannot avoid, right? You cannot avoid this tree because I mean, you pick a vertex and you give it five neighbors. You already have this tree, right? So I said, okay, let's take a more interesting. I mean, we said let's take a more interesting example. So we took this example, and we saw that we could not avoid this, right? I mean, we have not proved it. I mean, there are other possibilities. You could join two with things outside and so on, but you will see you cannot avoid it. Okay, we could not avoid. Is that clear? Or if it's not clear, then we can again go for a different way, meaning that we can try to do it in a different. Right? So just think, is it clear? No, we cannot avoid if T was smaller. Why? If I you make you want to make this T smaller, it will only get worse. Right? Yeah, if we just think like that. Yeah. So this is very it seems obvious now, but we have not proved it. And try to think of a proof. And in fact, the proof will if so if you spend more time on the cuts and vertices well ideas, the cut edges and cut vertices well ideas that we were doing some weeks back, that will actually help in the proof. So let's revisit that. And we had some unfinished things there also. But this was a very important problem. Okay. It has this applications also. I mean, it's very phenomenal, right? It means that you can find all the n to the power n minus 2 trees in this graph G. That's something. That is something, right? I don't know what all it means. Yes, that's what we have proved, right? Because see, the T was arbitrary. right? And the graph was fixed. Right? That's why I wrote the word. I think Douglas West doesn't use the word arbitrary. Douglas West, I think, says, I have the book here. So if T is a tree with K edges and G is a simple graph, then T is a subgraph. Well, because this is for mature mathematicians, so they pick out the thing. Even though when I read this in my first year, I didn't get the thing of that. I said, okay, I can prove it. Let's move on. But now sometimes this is a very weak statement. What all it means, I don't know. This can be very deep. Yes, in the sense that you can just try to take different T's, different trees, and you can see that all of them you can find. What do you mean by orientations? Even though orientation is a pretty interesting concept in graph, you could take all orientations, then you get something interesting, so on. That's why I thought, okay, that's fine. In fact, but when I say that you can find all n to the power n minus t two trees, I think I am overstating the overstating the effectiveness of this proof, actually, of the statement, because you see you will soon realize that indeed in fact there are not n to the power n minus 2 trees, but number of different trees is actually much less. How many is it? Nobody knows the exact formula. There is no exact formula, but number of different trees. Now we will. I'm not yet going into this a more mathematical view of different. Like the one written here and the one if you write on your paper, we consider it to be the same one, right? So we have that much from the very beginning. But even trees, which we are calling different, and actually a lot of trees are not different. So we will have to introduce that notion language, because it's too many. This n to the power n minus 2, actually, we don't have so many. I mean, we have so many trees if you consider labels, but we don't have so many trees if you are actually interested in the structure. So it's not actually that we don't have so many trees. But that requires, we'll have to bring in matrices and some algebra to actually understand that. So we will see that. Let's isomorphism. And that is a heavily studied problem in computer science also, whether two graphs given, whether they're isomorphic or not. So the number of different trees is much lesser. Means the number of different designs, right? Like this tree is the same as, I mean, if you shuffle the labels, right? They're different, okay? And so on. So we'll talk about that later. Okay. What was the next thing I was going to say? Yeah, the next thing was about cut vertices. And there were some good theorems that we had to prove there. So we'll do it one minute. Let's start. So first, let me go with cut vertices, cut edges. Now these are very, because these edges and these vertices are special properties, and so they are important in proofs. Okay. And so let's see. Let's begin with cut edges. Let me just use the word cut edge. Yeah. Would anybody like to define this or say roughly what this means? I think saying roughly what this means is better. Say it in your own words. Yeah, I think that is perfect. Yeah. So I will say G is a connected graph to start with. But actually, you're right. You do not need to say the word connected. You can just say that an edge whose removal increases the number of components. But I don't think that is called a cut edge, but that depends. But let's just stick with connected graph. Okay. Yeah, let me just say connected. Let G be a connected graph. Connected graph here just means in one piece. You can go from any point to the other. Yes, right. But I do not know if that is taken as a universally accepted definition. That I don't know if they call it cut edge. I think at least in the beginning chapters, cut edge is just for start with a connected graph, zero pieces, an edge whose removal increases the number of pieces by from 0 to 1. That's called a cut edge. Okay. What you're saying is more general. That I do not know if that is called a cut edge. I do not think, I mean, I've read whatever I've read from this book. I do not think that is true. Yeah. No, that's not true. That has some different, anyways. Yeah. But that's similarly important. I mean, that will be a cut edge for the component, for some component, right? That's why we don't need a definition for that thing, that kind of thing, which increases the number of components, because that will be a cut edge for some component of the graph by this definition of cut edge. So that's fine. But let's come to this. So GB, a connected graph. So remember, cut edge is always one edge at a time. Okay. I'm not saying you remove two edges and it becomes disconnected and so we call them cut edges. No. One edge whose removal does it is called a cut edge. There might not be any cut edge. Okay, so if E is in the graph, so I'll use this notation slowly, so it is an edge of the graph such that G minus E, I should say this minus E, but yeah, whose removal, so that this is a disc, but you can understand removing E is a disconnected graph. So just stating it like this. It's important to have a clear definition, because when you're writing, it condenses things. It also maybe helps you to think clearly, especially when we get lost a little bit in terminology. So it's a disconnected, and to be clear, it's a disconnected graph. Okay, so here is a very simple exercise. Define trees in terms of, so this is very simple, in terms of cut edges. So how can you describe trees in terms of cut edge? Yes, exactly. That is exactly what a tree is, right? If every edge is a cut edge, then it's a tree. And 1 minute, yeah. And if it is the tree, then every edge is a cut edge. So this is simple. Yeah. Right, so. But leaves, yeah, but leaves are slightly different. Leaves are, yes, exactly. So that's right. That's where I'll be coming. Okay. But this cut edge is a very simple thing. Okay. And just to say it, an edge, this probably all of you already know, you have already used this, an edge is a cut edge if it belongs or does not belong to no cycle. You can prove this is very simple. This we have used repeatedly. So yeah, cut edges, I don't have much to say now. Okay. But cut vertices are where the interest is. So cut vertices are the dual concept. Edges removed by vertex. So I'm not going to define it. You can just, it's the same definition, but just it's removed by edges. Edge is removed by vertex. So again, a cut vertex is the vertex whose removal disconnects the graph. So a cut vertex is a vertex whose removal will disconnect the graph, right? Just the same thing. What we want to prove is this, which I have not seen stated anywhere in this form. Probably it gets too easy after some point, but maybe for us it's good enough. Every graph G. So just to give you a quick example, if this is the picture, then this is not a cut vertex. right? Because if you remove it and remove edges along with it, you do not get a disconnected graph. So that's not a cut vertex. Okay. Does this graph have any cut vertex? Can you find a cut vertex? No, a vertex, not edge. Cut vertex. Yeah, not three, not four. Two. Right. Yeah, if you remove two, then you're gone, right? You get disconnected. If you remove two, then you have to remove the edges and you get two pieces. Two is gone. That's not a two is gone. Two is not creating a piece, but you have two pieces, one and three, four, right? So two is a cut vertex. No. I'm not going to, I just going to give you an example. Every graph G has at least one no cut vertex. It's the opposite. So every graph has at least one vertex, which is not a cut. But let me state it like that. This was just for intuition, just to see it. Has at least one vertex. So a leaf kind of thing. Okay, maybe I've said, which is not a cut. That is what we really want to prove. So having cut vertex is not important, right? Because you can take the complete graph. It doesn't have any cut vertices. But a vertex not being a cut vertex is important. So not having cut vertices is impossible. Sorry. I mean, not having no cut vertices is impossible. You will have no cut vertices. Not every vertex can be a cut vertex. Saying the same thing. You're right, but see, I've not said a connected graph. But your idea is exactly what we need. And we had. Yes, right. So I will not say the further proof. Please do this on your own. But the idea is that this is very simple, right? Just start with G, then go to a connected component. I mean, if the connected components are all points, then there is a problem. So that's an exception, but that's okay. Then the graph has no edges. I mean, if a graph has no edges, then I think I'm making a mess. I'm sorry. No. You are right. So in the very definition of cut vertex, we need to assume connectivity. I'm sorry, right? So there are two kinds of things, okay? Cut vertex is, if you define it like G is connected V is a cut vertex. To discuss is getting a little logical, right? Not very interesting. V is a cut vertex if G, removal of the vertex, so this is from the vertex that I'm removing, is disconnected. If you take this definition, then you can just go to the spanning tree, right? You can take the graph, rich graph, and from the graph, you can make the spanning tree that we always know it exists. That's a phenomenal thing, right? Every connected graph has a spanning tree because trees can be found easily. We have already shown that long time back. You take the spanning tree. Now in the spanning tree, which is a lighter graph, right? It's a sparser graph. There, if you remove a leaf, there will be leaf. You remove a leaf, and this is still connected, right? Then it means that the graph, in the graph, if you would have removed this, the graph would have still been connected. The graph is richer than this. The graph has more edges, so it's clear. So once again, you know, finding trees in places is this important thing. Going to the extremal structure was important to prove something about general graphs, because it allows, because you can go there, it is extremal, so you, the situation doesn't get worse. I mean, in the sense that if it's true in the extremal case, then it is true here, very simple, right? And so we go there and we prove it, because there we have more properties. I mean, you don't have to go, you can still do a write a proof or induction or something, but yeah. But here is the second definition, and this is the definition which you might meet, okay? GB graph. V is a cut vertex if G minus V has more connected components. Okay, so you understand what this means, more connected components than G. And once again, you, this is the same thing, just take a component and find its spanning tree and do it. So here the second definition is V is a cut vertex, or maybe I should say K cut vertices if the graph has K components and becomes K, so something like that can be said, and you know, you put another parameter and you generalize the definition. But yeah, the point is that whose removal increases the number of components, and you will always find something which does not do that. Okay. So the claim after this definition, claim is that you will find a vertex whose removal does not increase the number of components, right? So you have this G, imagine, yeah. Yes, yes. Hmm. Does every cut vertex? No. That's a good question. Maybe, I don't know. Depends on how you see it. No. But the answer is no. So does every cut vertex have a cut edge attached? No. Try to prove this, or just give an example. Everybody should try, can try this, right? Just think of a graph where there is a cut vertex, but it, there's no cut edge. Yeah. Yeah, basically, yes, right? Basically, the point is that removing a vertex can have a much more drastic effect than removing an edge. Right? So removing a vertex can disconnect the graph, but yeah, just draw an extra line is the thing. I mean, just draw this extra line. No. No, that's the very weird. So let's first make a small example. No, that's not as against the definition. Let's make a small example. So I need to be careful. Wait, no. So sorry, let's make a triangle. Yeah, that is. No, that does not work, because it's a cycle. No, but here the problem is that there is no cut vertex also, right? If you remove this, it doesn't get disconnected, right? Okay, so that's an interesting, There are theorems like this, which, wait 1 minute. So let me think. One second. If there is, so yeah, this associated word have attached. This is not well defined, but the point is that, look, if you have a vertex which disconnects the graph, wait. You have a vertex which disconnects the graph, then you must have an edge that disconnects. Oh, wait. So yeah, this might be yes, in a weaker sense. Let's think about this. Yeah, this is an interesting question. So if you have a vertex V, let V be a cut vertex. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that removal of V will disconnect the graph. Everybody's fine with that, right? That's the definition. So how would this structure look? Well, how would it look? And this will be important for us when we do balancing a tree. So something like that, I think. Here you see V is a cut vertex. So see, if you want to answer this question, I don't know. So let's say we don't know, none of us know the answer, right? So what do? We start with a cut vertex and we explore. If I have a cut vertex, then how will my graph look like? You see, since it's a cut vertex, its removal will destroy the graph, it will disconnect the graph. It means that there is one big blob, one big component, and one big component this side. There may be other. Yes, yeah, means there's nothing in between, right? That's right. And there may be more, but let's keep two, because it doesn't change anything. Such that, let's call this, let's call this C1 and let's call this C2. Such that there are edges like this. There may be many edges, okay, from V to the first component, and many edges from V to the second component. Okay. But there is no edge between C1 and C2. This is how the situation has to look like. Do you agree? Does everybody agree? V is a cut vertex, so it has to look like this. Yeah, so something, so the form by C, what could change? What else could happen is, okay, let's say the situation was not like this, right? Then are we allowed to have edges here like this? Are these yellow edges allowed, anyone? Remember, V is a cut vertex. Yes. And to say it more directly, just saying, is that if you remove V, the graph doesn't get disconnected. If you have these yellow lines, then removing V will not disconnect the graph. Not disconnected. Right. Yes, that's right. So everybody sees that now. If anybody has, please, because see, knowing this general, like the given a condition, being able to draw a general blueprint, or it doesn't have to capture every case, but to some extent it should, right? Is a very art, which I'm very bad at that, actually. There are many theorems which actually do this kind of thing, and I keep forgetting those proofs of those theorems because I'm not good at drawing the right blueprint to prove it. Many theorems like this, which is very crucial to do this. And so, yeah, so this must be, and see, and but yeah, if you actually, I'm wrong, there can be something like this. There could be another component, and you could have like this, but again, there would be nothing like this. So 3, 4 doesn't matter, right? 2 will answer the question. Okay. No yellow edge. So you see, it must look like this. Okay. Now let us see, is there a cut edge? Now let me write this. This is what you should ask yourself. Must there be a cut edge? Must there be an edge whose removal disconnects the graph? But one edge, see, you want one edge whose removal will do it. Is there? No, but removing one edge will not do it. Think about it. May not do it. Right. And just if you want to write it in exam, or just to say it more clearly, you can just draw a picture here. You can draw something rich here. So just removing one edge, for example, removing this, let me make this pink edge, right? This pink, okay, no. So I'm saying that must there be a cut edge means that I want to make it such that there is no cut edge, right? And it's very easy, right? Make C1 a complete graph, make C2 a complete graph so that they don't have any cut edges among those. So they don't create a problem. Just make it such. So you just want to create an example, right? Where a cut vertex doesn't imply a cut edge. So it's very simple. Make C1 complete. So make this a complete graph. Make this, I mean, there may be other edges also in this. Make it a complete graph so that they don't get disconnected. Now it's very clear. Where is a cut edge? Is any edge a cut edge? These pink are not cut because that's a complete graph. It's a rich graph. This is not cut. It's a complete graph. It's a rich graph. There is no cut edge. You will need to remove n choose 2 minus n around edges to get disconnected, right? So there are no cut edges to be found there. Do we have a cut edge among these greens? One edge. No, removing one edge will never do it. Remove this, it's not disconnected, still connected, right? Remove this, not disconnected, and so on. So cut edge is not there, right? So one vertex disconnects the graph, but one edge never disconnects the graph. We will prove Yes. So basically, why I'm drawing a complete graph? It's because I want to make an example where I don't find a cut edge. Think about it. That's a goal. Right? I want to show that this is incorrect. The feeling is it is incorrect. Right. So that's why I'm making a situation where there is a cut vertex, but I want to make a situation so that there is no cut edge. A worst counterexample, right? And making counterexamples, I think should always come before if you want to end up making a theorem, reading up your theorem, being able to prove a theorem is one thing, but making theorems, predicting results, you have to work a lot with counterexamples to get a sense of what that kind of structure is. Then you can modify the statement so that every cut vertex implies a cut edge, some condition. But I'm not asking such questions because I don't even myself know what kind of answer I'm saying. Okay, so that's some random thing which you can think of if you want to. But there are results where there are huge family of graphs where having a cut vertex implies cut edges. In particular, if there are graphs which can be drawn in such a way where none of the edges intersect. If you have graphs which can be drawn where none of the edges intersect, so this is a big no-no. Those are called planar graphs. They are, for reason analysis, you will know that can be embedded in the plane. But we will talk about that later. In those cases, it's true. And that's a huge family of graphs. And that's why a lot of problems which are not solvable algorithmically are solvable for such graphs. So this is true in a lot of cases. But what I wanted to say is a very fundamental result, which I am not, I don't know what that was. Yeah, so I think it can be generalized as follows. So what you have shown here is that you may have one cut, one vertex removing is okay. So let me first state it clearly. This was a good question. Yeah. So this example, you know, so point is that a, yeah. Let me put it in a slightly different way. Removing one vertex is enough, but removing one edge is not enough. Right. Okay. So removing one vertex is enough. It disconnects the graph, but removing one edge does not disconnect the graph. We have found many. We have found one example. You can construct infinitely many examples. Once you see this, I was thinking of a different way to say this. Now it crossed. I missed it. What was it? Mm-hmm. Yes. So that yes, that's right. So then what's the question? No, edges are, no, this attached is not in the sense of that attached. This attached is like associated. Like, so there is this, so let me put it like this. Associated is the right word. Attached is wrong. Even associated is not very good, but I'll say it better now. But just to take a transition, I'll say associated. And what I'm trying to say is that you have this vertex which disconnects the graph. Right, but for that vertex, but there is no partner edge. There is no one edge which the vertex can use. He needs all the green edges. One edge is not going to do. Okay, that is the thing. So yeah, so to put this very mathematically, it is like if a graph has one cut vertex, should it have one cut edge? And the answer to that is no. We have seen the example, like this example. There is a cut vertex, but there is no cut edge. And this certainly means that there is no cut edge associated with this because the whole graph doesn't have a cut edge. Obviously, the word associated is still not mathematically defined, but the answer will be obviously no because we have a cut vertex, but there is no cut edge. We have killed the problem in that sense. Right? This becomes hopeless now. It's impossible. Yeah, so we have put it like this, removing one vertex is enough, but removing one edge is not enough. Obviously, at least one vertex was needed. Okay. Now, so just what Pragya said, that when you remove a vertex, you remove the associated edge with it. That's obviously in the definition. But that will tell you something very interesting here. If the reverse question, which you can either come just ask the reverse question if you just you know, like to swap the things and ask questions and ask yourself or ask whatever, saying that try. If you just like to swap things and try, does every cut edge imply cut vertex? But that's the good way to do mathematics. I mean, that's some extent, but it becomes very inefficient later on because you don't know if the questions are good that you're asking. But if you think about it in this angle, that removing one vertex implies removing at least one edge, right? This is, so let me write it here. I mean, from here we will actually come to a very big, it's a theorem which is significantly hard to prove. We cannot prove it for some months, I think. Okay, but we will arrive at it. In a sense, you will be able to predict it. So the thing is that removing, so this is the thing. Now the other way we see this is just obvious, but writing it, because when you write removing one edge implies removing, wait, oh, what am I saying? Removing one vertex implies removing one edge. at least one edge. Moving one vertex implies removing at least one edge. We all agree with this. This is the definition. So now it makes sense to ask, right? If there is a cut edge, then what can we say? This is the next question to ask, right? If you're sitting down, this is the next question to ask. We're just thinking, exploring the topic, right? This question comes in more, right? When you just see this. Removing one vertex means that you're removing one edge, right? So if there is a cut edge, meaning that removing some edge is enough, then obviously one of the partner edge vertex remove. Yes, right. That's exactly. So I'll just write that now. No need to say this. Yeah. So this means that I think, but we'll see it again. We'll see it in example maybe. Cut vertex. Sorry. Uh-huh. There is a cut edge implies there is a cut vertex. Okay. There is a cut edge implies there is a cut vertex. Because it's clear, right? I mean, if there is an edge whose removal is breaking up the graph, then you remove this vertex. Now this edge will obviously get removed and the graph will be disconnected. Okay, there is an exception when this component is just one point, but those are some small exceptions. Okay, you can think of them. But the main thing is this. Okay, if there is a cut edge, then there is a cut vertex. Now you put it like this. If one edge is enough, then one vertex is enough. Just seeing the same thing from different perspectives is the key. Okay, writing the same statement in this way. Now, what is the next thing to question? What if I remove this? What if I replace this with K? If there is a graph which gets disconnected after removing k edges, so there is some graph which does not get disconnected when you remove one edge, but it gets disconnected when you remove k edges, it needs k edges. It doesn't need k edges, it could do with k minus one also, but forget about those things. Let me just put a number. I mean, those are some logical issues. So the point here is that if 10 edges is enough, then 10 vertices is also enough. So if there are 10 edges whose removal will disconnect the graph, then does it mean you can find 10 associated vertices? Is this true? And you can easily find the answer to this if you just, instead of 10, take 2, make some graphs. Take 3, make some graphs. Answer is yes. This is the Hart theorem. If removing k edges will disconnect the graph, it means that there will be some k vertices also, which are not associated in a simple way, but there are some. But it's not too algorithmically, it can be found actually. If I give you the edges, you can algorithm. Yes. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. But K will be enough. Yeah. This is the thing. And if someone wants to take it, try to prove it. It's a challenge. You can try to prove it. It's a little difficult. You can still do it. But yeah. This is studied in what is called connectivity, where, you know, how robust your net. Basically, that's the word I think it's used in some book. How robust your network is. So we were studying connectedness. But then you quantify that thing and you study connectivity. How many points I need to remove from the line is connected, right? In some sense, but removing a point makes it disconnected. the plane is connected, but removing a point does not make it disconnected. Connectivity is the key, whether you are studying computer science or mathematics. In mathematics, it's used to define dimension of a space. In computer science, is basically, you know, minimum number, the last optimization questions, you know, so on. And then a lot of things. This actually leads to a whole slew of theorems, min-max flow, all sorts of things. It starts all sorts of things from here, like in many, many twists. Okay, so that we will not see, at least for some time. See them. Oh my God, it stood 10:48. Okay, so I'll stop today. Actually, I don't know, I'm more energetic because I didn't have dinner today. Somehow, some schedule got here. And